Well, good morning, and can I welcome everybody to this, the fourth meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. The first item for the committee to consider is whether to take agenda item three in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much. The principal item on our agenda this morning is consideration of the 2021-22 audit of the Crofton Commission, which has been laid before Parliament and upon which we have got an evidence session this morning with three witnesses. Can I welcome our three witnesses this morning? Stephen Boyle, Auditor General, Pat Kenny, who's a Director, Audit and Assurance for Deloitte, and Kirsty Ridd, who's an Audit Manager for Audit Scotland. We've got questions to put to you, but before we get into those questions, Auditor General, could I ask you to make a short opening statement? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I prepared this report under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. The report brings to the Committee's attention progress made by the Crofton Commission during 2021-22 following significant weaknesses identified in the previous year. I reported to you on these issues in October of 2021, and my last report noted deficiencies in governance, leadership, and business planning that had been identified by the auditors, Deloitte. This committee subsequently undertook its own inquiry into those findings. Convener, I'm pleased to report that the Crofton Commission has worked quickly to address the recommendations and has implemented all the recommendations made by the auditor in their 2021 audit report. Governance arrangements have been revised, roles and responsibilities are now more clearly defined, leadership and relationships have improved, and medium-term financial planning has also been strengthened. I welcome this early progress. The actions taken will take time to bed in, and it's important that the Commission's board, the Chief Executive, and their sponsor team continue to work together effectively to ensure these improvements are sustained. I will continue to monitor the Crofton Commission's progress and report further in public as required. Convener, I'm joined this morning by Pat Kenny from Deloitte and Kirsty Ridd from our Performance Audit and Best Value team, and the three of us look forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. And I'll go straight away to questions and invite the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, to put the first question to you. Sharon.
Okay. Good morning. Your report states that the auditor has assessed all 41 recommendations from the 2021 audit report as being fully implemented by the Commission. 34 of the recommendations were in relation to the significant weaknesses in leadership and governance arrangements identified in last year's audit. It's a lot of recommendations, so are you content that the significant issues have been adequately addressed in what seems quite a short period of time?
I think I'll cover a number of those points, Deputy Convener, and I'll certainly turn to Pat Kenny in a moment actually to say a bit more about what he and his colleagues in Deloitte found. I think it's absolutely the case. 41 recommendations is no small amount of effort required to address the scale of challenges that the committee heard during its own evidence last year and as set out in the audit reports. The scale of progress is significant. And you know, in Pat's own annual audit report that he prepares on the conclusion of his audit, he maps all of those recommendations, the progress, the management action taken, and the judgment that Deloitte have reached on the progress. And we can come in to set out in more detail across the various themes as you wish. So I think that's a time to kind of set out my introductory remarks. We're 12 months further on. We've seen evidence of progress, better relationships, better documentation, more clarity around roles and responsibilities, stronger business planning. I can go on about the kind of the topics. I think the point that we wish to emphasise today is that it's not a terribly long period of time with which to say all of the issues and the scale of the issues that you heard about last year are resolved and there wouldn't be a repeat. But there is far stronger basis for optimism and the progress against those recommendations that we've seen. I'll pause. I think Pat will certainly want to comment on the range of those recommendations and the progress therein. Pat.
Yes, I mean, I think as the Auditor General mentions, the key thing will be the sustainability of the recommendations. I was impressed by the desire of the Commission to get things right. They really did get their sleeves rolled up, and they were. I detected strong commitment to addressing the weaknesses. And I was satisfied that I had the evidence, the audit evidence, to confirm that all the recommendations had been implemented. But the key thing will be that for the auditor to continue to keep an eye on it going forward, and just to ensure that the sustainability is fully delivered. I think that will be a key imperative.
Thank you. I know some of my colleagues have got questions on the sustainability and keeping up the momentum, but it is an awful lot of recommendations in a short timescale. So do you think, if they're successful, which we hope they are, do you think there's lessons learned there and good practice that could be shared with others?
So Pat may want to comment on this as well. The volume, I've not seen a volume of recommendations from an auditor of 41 recommendations for improvement, and then that volume to then be delivered together with the evidence. I think it's an important point Pat makes, that there's been a real willingness to accept the recommendations. There's not been a defensiveness, as we occasionally do see on the back of audit reports. Whether that translates into good practice, I think it's something we'd want to see sustained evidence of progress before we would reach a judgment that this progress here can act as a template for other public bodies. There will be some bits that are very successful, but I think we probably just want to be a little bit cautious for a period of time yet before we advocate that that's the model that should be applied elsewhere. Pat will have a perspective, I'm sure.
No, I just absolutely agree with that. I was very impressed by the total lack of defensiveness in terms of the recommendations, and acceptance that they had to put things right. But the key thing, I've now handed over the audit role to a new set of auditors, but I've emphasised to them that you really have to keep an eye on this in terms of that sustainability dimension, because it's far too early, I think, to say, you know, that, you know, we're completely satisfied, and that, you know, that matters have been completely put to bed. That ongoing momentum, sustainability, is absolutely essential, and it's very important that the auditor keeps a close eye on that going forward.
Thank you.
Thanks. I mean, it strikes me that it is it's a 6-page report, and a lot of it is reflecting on the recommendations and lessons that were put at the point of the last Section 22 report on the Crofton Commission, and indeed on this committee's own conclusions. I just wonder whether it wouldn't have served transparency a little bit better if you had the 41 recommendations listed and some kind of tracking of how they had been progressed, so that we had a sense. And I don't know whether you alluded to that being something that was part of the internal audit, but as far as the published document before us is concerned, that's obviously not captured. And I wonder whether that's something that you would consider.
Yes, absolutely, Convener. Apologies if that's not something before the committee. The annual audit report that accompanies the conclusion of the audit, which is the document that all auditors who are appointed by the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission prepare for public sector audit, sets out in detail the recommendations. So we chose not to replicate that in our own Section 22 report, but they are there for transparency purposes. There's a published document, it's available on Audit Scotland's website, that maps the recommendations that were already in the public domain together with the auditor's judgment on the management action that's been taken.
Okay. Maybe it's just me. I just thought for completeness it would be useful, given the scale of the recommendations and you know, the breadth of them. I think seven were on financial sustainability, and the other 34 were on governance and transparency. It might have been useful to capture that here, but I hear what you're saying. Craig Hoy's got some questions. Craig.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Ball. Obviously, the report is optimistic and I think reflects a significant amount of work that's obviously been done by the Crofting Commission. I suppose looking forward, my concern would be how could this be sustained? And I think paragraph 20 in your report says the progress made by the Commission over the last year is welcome. The activity and actions taken will take time to bed in, and this must remain an area of focus for the Commission to ensure that the improvement is sustained. And you say that I will continue to monitor the Commission's progress to consider further reporting in public as necessary. Just in terms of the use of that word, sort of bed in, what in practical terms do you still need to see happening before you would have surety that actually that this has been a turnaround rather than just a good plan that could subsequently be badly executed?
Yeah, I think the part of the conversation is already, Mr. Hoy, and we set out in our report, is that there's been very significant progress by the Crofting Commission in a short period of time, and it is that short period of time that won't necessarily allow us today to give absolute assurance that all of the issues identified are tackled and will not recur. The committee will recall that your predecessor committee took evidence on the Crofting Commission in respect of concerns in 2016. I am not drawing an alignment between what we have today and history, but it can perhaps illustrate that, you know, events can reoccur. The Crofting Commission and their sponsor team, the non-executives and the executive team, all have to work very hard to make sure that there isn't a repeat of the issues that featured in the report last year. We can say a bit more just about some of the steps that have been taken that give them better cause for progress. So last year's report and the committee's own report rightly featured on the lack of clarity around roles and responsibilities, how that was affecting relationships between the commissioners and the executive, the dynamic with the sponsor team. The new framework agreement, the new code of governance that's in place, gives greater clarity and that can allow for the sustained progress that we expect and hope to see, along with some of the other steps that they're taking on workforce planning, financial management and so forth. All of these point in the right direction, Mr. Hoy, but I think it's going to take a bit more time, and that's why I'm allowing for further public reporting. I think given the committee's own interest in this and the scale of the issues, it's something I'll want to see and I'll take a view over the course of this year's audit.
Yeah. So just in those terms, my concern would be that whilst the focus of yourselves and the press and the public is on the organisation, they could have a process of kind of quite effective window dressing. So how long do you think it will take that quite intense process of scrutiny? How long would you effectively want to remain on their backs for to make sure they don't fall back into bad old habits?
So you would expect me to say this. Every audit of a public body is designed to be effective and robust. Yeah. You know, so we will always bring to the committee's attention matters of public interest through our audit work. As Pat rightly mentioned, so there's a change of auditor this year in the public audit model in Scotland. We rotate typically every 5 years, this year every 6 years, allow for an extension as a result of the pandemic. New auditors will always come in with a fresh perspective. They're required to do so by auditing standards really every year to reset their expectations of management quality and so forth. So the incoming audit team, facilitated by the very thorough handover that they've had from Pat and his colleagues and Deloitte, will do that work. And very central to the code of audit practice that we have in Scotland requires external auditors to take a view on governance, leadership, financial sustainability, the issues at the very heart of the matters that the committee has considered over the past 12 months. I'll take a view at the conclusion of the audit as to whether that progress is being sustained and, if necessary, report further.
Thank you.
OK, thanks. Willie Coffey's got some questions to put. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Stephen, I wonder if you could say a little bit more about the impact of all of this on the crofting community itself. Clearly, there's been a heck of an amount of work has had to be carried out by the Commission and putting in place procedures and so on, and the Code of Corporate Guidance and all that that you refer to. But what about the impact on crofting services as a whole? And have you any sense of the response of the crofting community to all of this and how they, what they feel about it?
Morning, Mr. Coffey. It's a really important point, actually, and I think sometimes we can forget, or risk forgetting, I should say, that, you know, as we're looking at leadership, governance matters, and so forth, actually, this is a public body that's set up to provide a service to Scotland's crofters, crofting communities, and, you know, it's a very important role that it has. I recall from our evidence last year, and I'll bring Pat in a moment, just to say a bit about some of the performance of the organisation that might touch on the heart of the question that you're answering. Last year, we said that in spite of some of the issues, that the performance of the Crofting Commission hadn't been noticeably impacted by the events that had unfolded. You know, they had still, allowing for COVID, performed largely as expected. This year's report sets out in a bit more detail, I'd say, as to the performance of the organisation. Pat can speak to that as he wishes. But it's fundamentally at the heart of it that there is always a huge risk of distraction from the effectiveness of the organisation because of the issues at play. So there are a variety of performance. We've seen some, you know, that they are meeting their performance targets, other areas that they're not. Before handing to Pat, I would say, Mr. Coffey, actually, what is a positive feature of the Crofting Commission's annual report and accounts is that they are showing an alignment to the national outcomes, the national performance framework, that we haven't seen everywhere. So again, there's kind of signs of progress about the overall arrangements in the organisation. I'll pause there. Pat may want to come in about the organisation's performance in any detail that he wishes.
Yes, I think the business case that went to the Scottish Government, which we referred to for enhanced staffing of the Crofting Commission in 22-23, that business case did accept that there was a need for, I'm quoting, improved action and improved outcomes by the Commission in five key areas, and that included regulation in terms of regulatory processing, enforcing of duties and crofting development. So I think that there is that recognition that there was a need for improved outcomes, and that funding was approved. That was about 550,000 additional funding to allow more focus on these key outcomes. So again, I think the auditor going forward, the key objective there will be to provide assurance that additional funding has delivered those improved outcomes that the business case was based upon.
And in terms of the crofting community itself, have they been part of this process as a whole, do you think, in sharing some kind of engagement with the recommendations that have been made? And have they expressed a view in whatever forum they're able to about how successful they think the changes, revisions, the new code of guidance are, in fact, to deliver the services that they require? I mean, I'm always keen to hear what their views are in a process like this.
I think we'll share what we know about this. Actually, Pat might know a bit more about the extent of organisational engagement. Like, perhaps the one event I would point to is that there's been elections this year for new commissioners, and that's an opportunity for the crofting community to formally engage, you know, bring forward their plans, their agenda for, you know, the role that crofters will play in the running and the management of the Crofting Commission. So that forms an important part of their governance arrangements. On that point, I think, not to digress too far, I hope, but actually you'll recall, committee, that there was some concern about, I suppose, a blurring of boundaries between the role of commissioners and the operational management of the Commission. We've seen revised training arrangements, induction plans for new commissioners, so that those boundaries are clear. But the point you make is absolutely vital, Mr. Coffey, that actually the community that the Crofting Commission serves is able to have its voice about the role, the success, the outputs of the Crofting Commission. Pat may know more than I do. If we don't have any more detail to hand, we can come back with further information that we have.
Yes, I don't have much more I do know that it's very much on their agenda, and I know there was going to be another engagement campaign following the elections, and I would think that is something that the new auditors would follow up in the next audit cycle. But I think we could probably come back with more detail on that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. And my other question, really, you touched on it yourself, Stephen. It's about the code of guidance, the corporate code of guidance, and so on, and that it seems to be saying the right things and clarifying roles and responsibilities. Is it just a little early to form a view about the effectiveness of that? Is this what we mean by the bedding in time to have a look at it? And will someone have a wee look at that and subsequently to make sure that it's working?
Yeah, we absolutely will. And the auditors, as Pat mentions, will have that as part of their consideration of the effectiveness of governance of the Commission over the next 12 months. I think it is welcome progress on governance. I mean, this, at the heart of many organisations' challenges, you know, tends to be where there's a lack of clarity around governance, a lack of skills or effectiveness. All of those factors have been considered by the Crofton Commission through not just the core, actually the new framework agreement as well, sets out roles and responsibilities with far greater clarity than previously existed. Your own evidence-taking heard and from the judgments that we made in the audit about, I've forgotten the precise words, but the relationship of primacy or most importance was previously thought to be between the sponsor team and the chief executive is a now much more rounded set of arrangements with the convener and the commission through the sponsor team. There's transparency around that too. So engagement with the sponsor team is now communicated at every board meeting, so that the role of the board and the sponsor team with the overarching code of corporate governance and the framework agreement gives them a better platform to progress. It's not a tire clean bill of health, Mr. Coffey. I think that's the point looking to make this morning, that they put a great deal of effort into it. As time elapses, you know, and if there is a challenging management decision, governance event, this is where this framework will be tested. So we're not quite at that place yet, and I think that's something that we plan to keep a close eye on over the course of the audit years ahead.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much. And just to, I think, re-emphasise the point that it would be useful for us to see what interaction there has been between the Commission and the Crofton communities, because I think... whilst the arrangement of direct elections is something many of us would welcome, I think it's got to be more than that. It's got to be an ongoing relationship. So if it may be that we need to speak to the Crofton Commission themselves about that, but I think any perspective you got on that would be very helpful. Colin Beattie has got some questions. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Lord General, just before I ask the questions I'm thinking of, the elected members of the Commission, what is the process for that election?
So I'll bring Kirsty in, actually, who's looked into this in a bit more detail than I have at my fingertips. Before just kind of passing, the makeup of the board of the Crofton Commission has changed, but the committee, may recall, is comprised of both commissioners who are directly elected and also those that are appointed by the Cabinet Secretary. So there's a combination of both those factors. The timing, frequency and the election arrangements, Kirsty may know more. Again, if we don't have a disposal today, we'll come back to the committee.
In responding, maybe you could touch on how the elections are held and do they have a large participation? Are there competitions for the positions? I'm just curious.
Yeah, so elections to the Commission are held every 5 years, and it's done by a postal ballot out to all registered crofters or owner-occupier crofters. There's six regional constituencies, as mentioned in the report, and at the elections in the start of 2022, all six regencies were, constituencies were contested. There was a contest in every one of those. All crofters and owner-occupier crofters are eligible to stand for election if they're over the age of 16. And again, all registered crofters are eligible to vote in those elections as well.
I suppose that was one question I was going to ask is, are the elected commissioners all crofters?
So, by and large, yes, you have to be a crofter or an owner-occupier crofter to stand for election. There is a provision for a crofter to nominate someone who isn't a crofter to stand for them, and that nomination has to be set out in the election paperwork to show that they are a nominated person to stand. As far as I'm aware, all the members that were elected last year are registered crofters.
Okay, that's interesting. Let me turn to the questions that I've got here. Sponsorship. As you know, sponsorship has been a big issue with the Scottish Government, and the recent, fairly recent report from the Scottish Government on sponsorship indicated a large number of weaknesses. So, turning to the Crofting Commission, how strong is the sponsorship support that the Crofting Commission is getting? Do you consider it to be adequate? Do you consider it to be strong?
I would perhaps rephrase my answer slightly. I would say it is more effective than it was last year. So you took evidence from the sponsor team and from two director generals from the Scottish Government in terms of the sponsorship arrangements. We are seeing, and basing on our, I think there's two components to answer. One is about the kind of the interaction with the Crofting Commission's sponsor team. Those roles and responsibilities are much clearer than they were 12 months ago and prior to that. Set by the new framework document and the code of governance, that's giving what we would say is normal, effective sponsorship arrangements are happening between the Crofting Commission, its executive and non-executive, and that is being set out transparently for the board as well. So the relationship of consequence, I think is the phrase, is no longer directly with the chief executive, it is broader. So everything we've seen, and as Pat and his team have seen through the audit, is that that's operating effectively. I caveat my response somewhat, Mr. Beattie, because the effectiveness of sponsorship arrangements in the round that the Scottish Government deploys for its sponsor bodies. Many recommendations were made in the report that was produced by the Scottish Government, and as I noted in my Section 22 report on the Scottish Government, I still have some reservations about how effective all of those recommendations will be, or whether the Government yet has the skills and capacity to deliver upon all those recommendations, given the volume of change, the scale of the change of personnel and the scale of recommendations. So whilst we're noting progress and a framework platform within the Crofting Commission, I think there is still work to do across the piece for sponsorship and its in the Scottish Government and its bodies.
Will you be revisiting this yourself?
Yes, we are keeping a close eye on it. I'm very mindful of the recommendation that the committee made in its report on the Crofting Commission. Your interest in me undertaking further work on sponsorship across the piece. I'm taking that into consideration as we go through the next stage of our forward work programme. Whether we dedicate a specific piece of work on sponsorship or continue to report largely through the audit of the Scottish Government is something that I'll be consulting with colleagues and engage with the committee on further.
Just coming back to the Crofting Commission and its engagement with the sponsorship, are you satisfied that the changes that have been made within the Crofting Commission adequately reflect the proper relationship they should have with a sponsorship unit?
Yes, that's what we are seeing so far. So there is, and Pat can comment on this, again, we'll be closer and see how this relationship is working. But the changes, the right governance documents, the transparency of the interaction that they are having with the Scottish Government, together, as Pat mentioned rightly, the proper processes, business cases that have been prepared for future funding arrangements, all have progressing on a sponsorship dynamic that we would expect to see and one that's operating effectively. Again, Pat can comment in more detail on what he's seen.
Yes, it's just it's fair to say, Mr. Beattie, that the there was clear and obvious tensions in the past, and the initial report that I published, you know, identified several examples where the relationship wasn't working as it should have done, in terms of respective roles, blurring of roles. When I signed off the audit for my final year of audit, it was clear that those tensions were not there any longer, and that the relationship was on a level that you would expect for an organisation of that type. But I'd say again, the key thing would be that is sustained going forward. I do think there is a risk that, as the Auditor General mentions, that there may be a difficult decision, conflict, and that will be the key litmus test, I think, as to whether these new governance arrangements are fully operational. So far too early to say that it's totally, you know, fixed, but the tensions that were there in the past are not there now.
I'm fully taking on board the caveats about sustainability in terms of the progress that's been made. I mean, it's very welcome, it's excellent, but sustainability is an issue, as with any sweeping changes such as they've brought in over a short period. Are you aware whether the Scottish Government's public bodies unit has been involved in any of this?
So we certainly know that the sponsor team has been actively involved, and I mentioned a few minutes ago that training is a significant part of the revised arrangements to support the induction effectiveness of new commission members, new public board members. What I don't know is whether public bodies have been directly engaged with the public bodies unit, directly engaged with the Crofting Commission. But given the prominence with which training and induction features, I think it's safe to assume that the Scottish Government has brought wider expertise and resource into this. If that's not the case, then I'll come back to clarify that to the committee.
And just one last point on the sponsorship side. Remind me who the sponsoring body is, the sponsor.
So it is the Agricultural and Rural Economy Department is the sponsor team that oversees the Crofting Commission.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Sharon Dowie, I think, has got another question to put to you. Sharon.
Thank you. In the committee's report on the 2020-21 audit of the Crofting Commission, a recommendation was that the Crofting Commission and the Scottish Government put plans in place to regularly review the revised framework agreement to ensure that it remains fit for purpose. Do you know what plans are in place? What plan, if anything's been put in place?
I would need to check on that, Deputy Convener, about the timescale for the review of the framework agreement. All framework agreements have a timescale that are subject to review, and that can vary. So I'll need to check our records and come back. But if I think colleagues are in agreement, then we'd just come back to the committee to clarify exactly what that timeframe is.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I think it's not in the written report, but it's something which I think was alluded to earlier on, and that was about the increase in grant aid that's been provided for by the Scottish Government to the Crofting Commission. I think, did you say it was £550,000? And I think you also said that was in part to address an enhancement of staffing capacity. I suppose my two questions are, one, could you perhaps describe in a bit more detail what those job roles are? And was it to fill vacancies? Was it to increase capacity? Have there been particular log jams where things haven't been dealt with as speedily as they might have been by the Commission, and this is an attempt to address that? And secondly, are there other non-staffing costs which are being met through that increased level of grant aid that's been provided for?
I'm happy to start on that, Convener, and I'll bring Kirsty and Pat with anything else they wish to add. So we have a figure of £700,000 was the increase in the Crofting Commission's budget for the current financial year 22-23, and that takes its budget from 3.3 million to just a shade under £4 million for the year. £140,000 of this was identified to address inflation and wage pressures. The figure of £560,000 has been used to support workforce changes. Pat can comment, I think, about, I suppose, the business case for that. So there is an increasing in staff for the Crofting Commission. Some of it's to support its regulatory effectiveness, some of it's its back office functions, and has also been a restructuring of its senior management arrangements over the course of the year. Pat, and I think Kirsty might want to say a bit more as well, is that the important thing that we see in any significant budget changes, and this is, you know, in the context of the Crofting Commission, big changes, that that's supported by a business case, and that's something that we are aware of, that there was a business case to support that scale of change. Pat and then Kirsty can say a bit more.
Yeah, thanks, Auditor General. The 700k figure in total, as the Auditor General mentioned, 140k of that was to cover like core inflation, and the balance was really for staff enhancement. And the major components of the staff enhancement figure were 8 additional frontline staff for regulation and registration, and 2 senior posts to form a new senior management team. There was a reconfiguration of the senior management team. I don't know if you recall, in the initial report that I published, I suggested that the previous senior management team was too large for the size of the organisation. They had 9 roles, I think, from memory, and that has now been streamlined. So there's now 4 senior management positions, and changes to the level below some a much better strategic and operational split in terms of the staffing structure. The 2 new senior management positions were a director of crofting regulation and a director of corporate services. And I think and those 2 roles, with the chief executive and the officer and solicitor, now form the senior management team. And to me, that's a structure which is much more in line with what you would expect for the size of the organisation, the scale of the organisation, and is comparable to other similar types of organisation in the public sector.
Yeah, I hear that, but just from my simple perspective, are you saying that there has been a reduction in the size of the senior management team, but it's costing more money?
There's been a reconfiguration overall. The previous senior management team, although it was 9, included more junior members of personnel. B3 grades, I think, is the typical grade. So there was really so what's happened now is that the team has been consolidated, but there was that additional funding for those 2 new senior positions. Yes.
And is that Audit General, I'll bring you. But is that a net increase in the budget to pay for senior management? It's not, is it just a rebalancing of the existing budget?
The overall impact per the business case, as I mentioned, was a 560k increase for increasing in staffing, but a lot of that, I think, as I mentioned earlier, was to improve those 5 priority outcomes that had been identified where improvements were required. So yes, in overall terms, there was additional funding for staffing overall. Yeah.
Auditor General.
Thanks, Convener. I think just with a slight bit more detail, I think one thing is we haven't audited this yet, and Pat hasn't either, so this will be something that will be subject to audit during the 22-23 audit. In overall terms, the business case, £560,000 to increase the workforce. Pat Wright mentions about majority of that is for increase in regulatory posts, but there are 14 new posts in total across the organisation. An aspect of the change is to restructure the senior management team, but I don't think it's a case that the increase in funding represents primarily to support senior management staffing salary changes. Majority of this is about investment in the regulatory team. All of that's caveated, convener, because we haven't audited this yet. This is just something that we've information has been provided to us. It will absolutely be part of our audit for the year ahead.
Yeah, that's quite reassuring. I mean, for the purposes of today, though, you said that you didn't think the majority of it had gone on to the senior management team. I mean, what is, in rough terms or in exact terms, if you've got it, what is the division of additional resource which is going into those frontline posts versus which is going into the senior management team?
So as I mentioned, it's our understanding that there are 14 new posts. What we don't know is how far they are in terms of actually recruiting to those posts, but the division relates to 8 new regulatory posts as well, together with a streamlining of the senior management team within the organisation. I would emphasise the point that Pat makes, that this is a small organisation. The senior managers identified, and they are set out in name and job title and salaries in the Crofton Commission's annual report and accounts, are not large salaries for senior managers. Now, these are in other parts of the Scottish Government would be considered to be relatively junior grades, but because of the it being a small organisation and the span of responsibilities, they are identified as senior managers. I think it is a reasonable step that the Commission have taken to better align the size of their senior management team with the scale of organisation that it is. We'll look into all of this further over the course of this year's audit.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I think there will be an interest and a public interest in the proportionate increases in the salary levels from the regulatory team that are presumably working on the front line, dealing with that side of it, and those who are in strategic senior management positions. And as I think there will also be an interest in what the net outcome is in the new structure compared to the previous structure. Can I turn to really a final point, which is to pick up something that you spoke about earlier on as well, and that's we've got new commissioners in, some elected, some appointed, I think. We were just interested in understanding what training and development they have been given. I think in answer to Colin Beattie's questions, you mentioned about the role of the public bodies unit, and there is obviously an expectation that training will be provided, but I think we identified that in our report as being something, especially with the expectation that there would be a new cohort of commissioners elected. I think we were interested in understanding what the quality of training is that's been provided to them.
Yeah, I'll happily start, convener, and Pat and Kirsty can come in as they see fit. From our understanding, one of the first things that the training has set out is that clarity of roles and responsibilities. So together with a clearer understanding of the framework agreement and the code of corporate governance, together with the wider support that Scottish Government provides, so Mr. Beattie mentioned public bodies unit, there is a programme of learning and development and training that the government has been working on. They have a governance hub for new public board members that takes members through a range of scenarios, but the accountability arrangements as well. It informs them about the role of this committee and so forth. And that's on the package that's available across the piece. We understand there's also a dedicated training plan about specifically for the Crofton Commission members, so that they understand more clearly the respective roles of commissioners and that of staff, which was a feature of previous reports. All of the building blocks, we would say, are in place so that new commissioners, together with existing commissioners, have a clearer understanding of who's responsible for what, and that they can avoid some of the pitfalls that brought us to preparing the report together with the recommendations previously. I'll stop in case colleagues want to come in with a bit of detail that supports that.
I don't have any further detail to add.
No. I think that covers it all, Auditor General. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, well, look, thanks very much indeed. Unless any of the committee members have got any further questions, I'm going to draw that session to a close. And thank you very much indeed to Pat Kenny, Stephen Boyle, Auditor General, and Kirsty Ridd. We've appreciated your input this morning. There are some things I think we may want to follow up, but that might be with yourselves, but also with, I think, with the Crofton Commission as well. So thank you very much indeed, Foyer Evans. I'm now going to close the public part of this morning's meeting. Thank you.